time a politician dies in America, I am asked by the press for a comment. I have three comments that I select according to the circumstances, and it's kind of like a final grade on an examination. Or an A. He serves the public with great distinction and departs with honor in his way. B. He serves the public long and well and will be missed by his many friends. C. Throughout his long record of public service, one thing was remarkable. He was never convicted of a felony. If the deceased was a Democrat, I am often asked to deliver a eulogy at his funeral. I wonder who will deliver my eulogy. I hope it's not some smart-aleck newspaper man who turns over a phrase like a grave digger turns a spade full of dirt. You probably saw what H.L. Mencken had to say about me in yesterday's Baltimore Sun. July 24th, 1925, everybody has seen it. I am told that Mencken himself arranged to have a bundle sent here to Dayton, Tennessee, so I'd be sure to see it. Bryan descended too deeply into the mud to be taken seriously hereafter by fully literate men, even of the kind who write school books. His career brought him into contact with the first men of his time. He prefers the company of rustic ignoramuses. It was hard to believe, watching him at Dayton, that he had traveled, that he had been received in civilized society, that he had been a high officer of state. He seemed deluded by a childish theology full of an almost pathological hatred of all learning, all human dignity, all beauty, all fine and noble things. He is a peasant come home to the barnyard. Why, if anyone is afflicted with a pathological hatred, it's Mencken. He calls the citizens of this community yokels. He was born with a roaring voice, and it has the trick of inflaming half-wits. His whole career is devoted to raising half-wits against their betters that he himself might shine. But for many years, I edited the newspaper, the Omaha World Herald. I never would have published such vicious sniping. Talk about descending to the barnyard. Why, in Tennessee, I never saw a face that had as little intelligence as Mencken's. During the trial, a bunch of young hotheads suggested tarring and feathering Mr. Mencken and riding him out of town on a rail. When I got wind of it, I called a meeting of the town fathers, prayed with them, and told them that such a thing would cast a shadow over the whole trial. They agreed, but said they didn't think they could control the hotheads. Mr. Mencken was warned of the plot and took a cab to Chattanooga that afternoon. He went home to Baltimore before the trial was over. Mencken is a cynic, a man who knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. No one would want a eulogy to come from a cynic. It should come from a poet. Have you ever known a poet who was a cynic? Have you ever known a cynic who was a poet? Now here is a truly great American poet, Vachel Lindsay. He wrote a wonderful eulogy for John Peter Altgeld. Now Altgeld was the governor of Illinois the first time I ran for president in 1896. He was a courageous but strange man. He had a hair lift and spoke with a lisp. When he pardoned the anarchists who were convicted of the Haymarket bombing, his enemies called him an anarchist. The Eagle That Is Forgotten by Vachel Lindsay. We have buried him now, thought your foes, and in secret rejoice. They made a brave show of their mourn, their hatred unvoiced. They snarled at you, barked at you, foamed at you day after day. Now you are ended. They praised you and laid you away. The mocked and the scorned and the wounded, the lame and the poor that should have remembered forever, remember no more. Sleep softly, eagle forgotten under the stone. Time has its way with you there, and the clay has its own. Sleep on, O brave-hearted, O wise man that kindled the flame. To live in mankind is far more than to live in a name. To live in mankind, far, far more than to live in a name. Who will remember? I was born on the 18th day of March, 1860. Now that was a presidential year, but I was too young to run. As soon as I was nominated, 36 years later, astrologers called to find the exact hour of my birth so they could check my horoscope to ascertain whether I'd be elected. I never had much faith in their calculations. Well, one astrologer declared that my horoscope indicated that I would be elected. I think that's the same astrologer who predicted a safe crossing for the Titanic. He was very much mortified by my defeat, more than I was myself. It's never easy to deal with defeat. Defeat wears you down. Nobody loves a loser, but it just didn't seem as hard to lose when I was young. When you get older, your confidence that you'll survive long enough to witness your ultimate vindication begins to fade. I was defeated 3 times as the Democratic nominee for president by the time I was 49 years old. But I have lived to see most of the important causes I was fighting for succeed. The graduated income tax, women's suffrage, the popular election of senators, the initiative and the referendum, antitrust laws, national prohibition. They are all an accepted part of American life today. To live in mankind. Now I am an elder statesman of the party, giving advice about how we can pick ourselves up off the floor on a regular basis. Seems like we find ourselves on the floor a lot these days with the party so badly split. I had a nice chat in 1924, just prior to the convention, with young Franklin Roosevelt, who came to see me at my home in Miami while he was vacationing on his houseboat. Poor fellas in a wheelchair, recovering from polio. Still has that same warm smile for everyone, though. I remember the first time I saw that smile. It was 1913, and I was the Secretary of State in Woodrow Wilson's cabinet. Young Franklin was the Assistant Secretary of the Navy to my dearest and closest friend in the cabinet, Josephus Daniels. It's interesting to note that Franklin's cousin, Theodore, was also the Assistant Secretary of the Navy in McKinley's first administration. It's good to finally have a Roosevelt who's a Democrat, though. Well, anyhow, I asked him about Governor Smith, knowing full well the reason he came to see me was to keep me from speaking out against his good friend, Al Smith. I told him that Governor Smith may be progressive, but his connections won't endear him to many of the delegates I talked to. what my best advice is to let the candidate be decided by the platform. Situations make issues, and issues make platforms, and platforms make candidates. At the 1924 convention, it took 103 ballots to come up with a Wall Street lawyer, John Davies, as our nominee. I had no choice but to support him, with my own brother, Charles, on the ticket as the vice presidential candidate. But Thomas Jefferson must have rolled over in his grave. Have you ever wondered how much more interesting memoirs would be if the author knew that they wouldn't be published until after he died? As precarious as my health is, I have often wondered, how will these words sound after I'm gone? Three ambitions entered my life before I was 6 years old. The first was to be a Baptist preacher. My father took me to an immersion one night, and when I saw the convert being dipped down into the pool of water, I asked my father, "Do I have to do that to become a Baptist preacher?" He said, "Yes." And that was the end of my ambition to be a Baptist preacher. That was also the end of my ambition to be a Baptist. I became a Presbyterian, and a dry one at that. My second ambition was inspired by a girl named Hester. Nearly grown, she promised to wait for me if I would become a farmer and raise pumpkins. When I announced that I was considering becoming a lawyer instead, she changed her mind. Later, she ended up marrying a cousin of mine who did raise pumpkins, and lots of children, too. My third ambition, to be a lawyer, was inspired by my father, Silas, who was a circuit court judge in Illinois. Father was deeply religious, and as a young man, he became critically ill, and he promised God that if he recovered, he would pray 3 times a day for the rest of his life. He kept that promise till the day he died. But you know, I never once saw him get down on his knees or heard him pray out loud. Father always said, a prayer should go straight to the ears of God. If someone else is listening, you end up saying words you want them to hear. You know, prayer must be one of those things you know that your parents must do, but you never get to watch them do it. You know what you mean. Whenever Father had a difficult decision to make in one of his cases, he always prayed for divine direction. And as soon as he got his answer, the lawyers could stop talking. And his father would say, what's the use of pounding on the log after the coon's gone? I remember one afternoon sitting on the courthouse steps and having a lawyer stop my father and ask him, if you decide all of your cases by divine direction, why is it the Illinois Supreme Court has reversed the Lord on 6 occasions? My father was not amused. He simply said, a Supreme Court was wrong. My father actually knew Abraham Lincoln. It didn't have much use for him, father being a Democrat and Lincoln being a Republican. Father sat on the platform during the last Lincoln-Douglas debate in Alton. He always said Senator Douglas won that debate. I remember before I left home to attend the Whipple Academy, my father gave me the 2 largest books in his library. I think about one of them was the Bible. Well, you're wrong. One was a Greek grammar book and the other one was Latin. Father always said the mark of a true gentleman is to be able to read the classic in their original. I didn't leave home to attend school until I was 10 years old. But by then, my mother taught me how to read and write. She was a wonderful teacher. When I first started to give political speeches, she came to one. I asked her what she thought afterwards. She said, "Will, there were a few good places in that speech where you might have stopped." My mother was a very strong woman. She bore 9 children and had the heartbreak of burying 4 of them before they were grown. Whenever the family would gather, she would always want us to sing. She always said, "A song is a prayer with wings. Whenever I sing, it's more like a rooster who can't fly." My visits with my mother were always like a tonic that restored me. I remember my last visit with her shortly before she died. She died 10 days before I received the nomination the first time for president. "Mother, this is Will. I've come all the way from Nebraska to see you." "No, Mary had to stay in Lincoln with the children." "No, they're all right. Remember, they were all here this last Christmas. They have a wonderful memory of that visit." "No, they're doing well." "Well, Ruth, she's over the measles and she loves to write stories. Will, well, he's into all sorts of mischief. Scared his mama half to death when he tumbled down the steps." "Grace is much better. Getting stronger every day." "Yes, Mom. I remember that song. Yes, I know it's your favorite. Mom, you come and I'll see if I can't remember all the words.
"That, Mother?"
"Oh, yes, there were a few good places in that song where I might have stopped." When I left home to attend college, my mother told me to leave the girls alone. She said, "You can't learn and spark at the same time." That is the only thing I ever discovered that Mother was wrong about. I met my wife, Mary, at an open house at the Jackson Female Academy. We called it the Jail for Angels. And I didn't exactly bore over at first, but one of her friends commented to her about the size of my mouth. She said, "That man could whisper in his own ear." Carrying on a romance with the student at the Jacksonville Female Academy required a great deal of ingenuity. I would suggest to some upstanding members of the community that they invite Mary to their home for the evening, and coincidentally, invite me at the same time. Mary got into trouble for sneaking out on a buggy ride with me and was actually sent home for a term. I wrote a letter of apology to her father, and Mary actually convinced him that I was not a fast young man, but had honorable intentions. I'll never forget asking Mary's father for her hand. Mr. Baird was a stern, upright man, and I think he rather enjoyed watching me squirm. Mr. Baird, I've been reading Proverbs a great deal lately, and I find that Solomon says that he who findeth a good wife findeth a good thing and obtaineth the favor of the Lord. Yes, he said, Solomon did say that. But Paul says that he who giveth her in marriage doeth well, but he who giveth her not in marriage doeth better. I was stumped, but not for long. Sir, I believe that Solomon would be the best authority on this point because Paul was never married while Solomon had a number of wives. Our engagement was a long one. Mary and I decided that we couldn't marry until I finished studying law at the Union Law College in Chicago and got my practice going to the point where I was earning $500 a year. I got a job in law school working for Judge Lyman Trumbull for $5 a week, sweeping the floors of his law offices, filling inkwells and copying documents. After my father died, Judge Trumbull was more than a hero to me. He gave me lots of fatherly advice. I remember one Saturday morning sweeping up the law offices and being surprised to see Judge Trumbull at his desk poring over his files, preparing for a trial where he was representing some poor devil who was suing the stockyard for a few hundred dollars for the loss of his leg. I was all excited about the moot court I had argued involving Judge Cox's charge to the jury in the trial of Guido for the assassination of President Garfield. Do you think that he was truly insane? I asked the judge. He just laughed and said, "Will, everybody in Washington's insane." Judge Trumbull was buried on June 27, 1896. At his funeral, I saw Clarence Darrow. Whatever differences I had with Mr. Darrow, we shared the same hero. When Darrow first moved to Chicago, he set up his law office in the same building as Judge Trumbull, and later they joined together to defend Eugene Debs before the United States Supreme Court after the Pullman trial. I delivered the eulogy at the judge's funeral. Throughout his whole career, Judge Trumbull was guided by personal convictions rather than party loyalty. He left the Democratic Party to support Lincoln because he opposed slavery. He lost his Senate seat when he folded his party to vote against the impeachment of Andrew Johnson. The advice Judge Trumbull gave to me before I first sought public office still lingers in my ears because he lived it. He said, "Will, winning an election is a thrill like no other on earth. But if it comes at the cost of abandoning your principles, you're not a winner at all. You've lost your soul." The soul of Lyman Trumbull was never lost. And today, that soul is marching to a victory celebration like no other in heaven. Lord, grant your servant Lyman a silver trumpet so that he might summon us to your side. Mary and I were finally married in 1884 after I finished studying law and got my law practice going. We built a house in Jacksonville with enough room for Mary's parents to move in with us, but there just didn't seem to be a lot of opportunity for young lawyers in Illinois. I was more impressed when I went to visit one of my law school classmates in Lincoln, Nebraska. Adolphus Talbot offered me a partnership and we moved to Lincoln. Mary's parents moved with us. Mary's father lived with us for 20 years. The last 15, he was completely blind. He could never read to his grandchildren, but he was a wonderful storyteller. As soon as we could afford it, we bought Fairview, so our three children could grow up in a real farm out in the country. I got my first taste of a national political convention at the age of 16 by climbing through the window in the convention hall in St. Louis. In 1884, I went to the convention in Chicago through the side door as a page, and I saw Grover Cleveland nominated the first time. In 1888, I went through the front door as a Nebraska delegate who voted for Grover Cleveland when he was nominated the second time. After that convention, I stumped for Cleveland in 24 counties in Nebraska that year. I'll never forget coming home from one of the speaking trips in the Cleveland campaign. I spoke at a rally at Gordon for over 2 hours. They wouldn't let me stop. I got home at dawn. Mary was asleep. I tiptoed in so I wouldn't wake up the children, but I had to wake her. Mary, there's something I have to tell you. I had a strange experience last night. I found I have a power over an audience. It's an incredible feeling. I can move them as I please. The whole room was focused on me, waiting for my next word. Last night, I spoke from my heart, and I found my audience was listening with their heart. Knowing what is in a person's heart gives you enormous power. It is a power that can move people and inspire them. God grant that I may use it wisely. Despite my splendid oratory, Grover Cleveland lost that election. Now, what's that letter? Here is a copy of a letter I wrote to Grover Cleveland after his defeat. We would rather fall with you fighting on for principle than succeed with the party representing nothing but an organized appetite. Your position on tariff reform was so wisely and bravely taken that I believe the party will look back to you in after years with gratitude and not reproach. Now that is the kind of letter I love to receive after my defeat. More often than not, this is the type of mail I got. Dear Mr. Bryan, I was so sure you would be elected, I bet the $40 I had set aside to mend the roof of our house. Now that the rain has come, my house is leaking badly. Please send the money at once. Now here's a nice one. Dear Mr. Bryan, I've read about all of the babies who were named in your honor. We became the proud parents of crippled boys and want you to know our three sons have been named William Jennings and Bryan. First time I ran for public office was in 1890 when I ran for Congress against a Republican incumbent named Bill Connell, who everyone said was unbeatable. I got lots of advice during that campaign. One of my supporters told me, "Now you speak everywhere and kiss all the babies. You can do it. You have mouth enough for both." I did speak everywhere. Connell and I debated 11 times. In one debate, he called me the boy orator of the Platte. The label stuck, but he didn't. And I beat Connell by more than 6,000 votes. When the newly elected Congress convened in Washington, Mary and I moved. We took our family of three children and Mary's father. Mary still found time to be a great help to me with my work in Congress. She had studied enough law to be admitted to the Nebraska Bar in 1888. We were quite a combination. I was the youngest man ever elected to Congress from Nebraska, and only the second Democrat. And Mary was the first woman ever to become a lawyer in Nebraska. That newly elected Congress that convened put the Democrats back in charge of the House by a 3-1 margin. Boss Reed wasn't boss anymore. The new speaker was a congressman from Georgia, name of Chris. He put me on the Ways and Means Committee, a choice assignment for a freshman. The big battle in that Congress was for tariff reform. Mary helped me polish up my speech that I was going to give the first time I spoke. We used our own experience to show how the tariff increased the price that we had to pay for the lumber to build our homes and the dishes and the carpets to furnish it. It was her suggestion that I use the illustration of Ulysses when he put wax in the ears of his sailors when they approached the island of the Sirens to compare to the Republicans turning a deaf ear to the farmers. I remember Mary smiling me in the gallery when I rose to give that speech. Mr. Speaker, it is said that when Ulysses approached the island of the Sirens, warned beforehand of their seductive notes, he put ears in the wax of his sailors. He put wax in the ears of his sailors. I was re-elected to Congress. And by then, we got Grover Cleveland back in the White House a second time. But that's when we had the big fight for the income tax. I led the fight to make up for the revenue loss with the reduced tariff with the graduated income tax, so those who could most afford it would pay the most taxes. I recall the argument being made that the 2% tax was so high that it would drive many of the finest citizens of New York to live abroad. Where would they go, I asked. The tax rate in Prussia is 4%, in Switzerland is 8%, and in Italy it is 12%. I thought that we were well rid of those who would expatriate themselves to live in a monarchy without an income tax rather than support a republic. We got our income tax, but the United States Supreme Court said it was unconstitutional. As my father would say, the Supreme Court was wrong. It took us nearly 20 years more to get our income tax, and we had to amend the Constitution to get it. The fight over the income tax was the first time I was called a demagogue. It wasn't the last time. Theodore Roosevelt, he called me an amiable and windy demagogue. I always did have a way with words. Speak softly and carry a big stick. It was supposed to be his motto. But every time I saw him speaking, he was shouting. Well, Thomas Jefferson was called a demagogue too. If a man's ear is tuned to the slightest pulsation of the pocketbook, he is called a statesman. But if he dare listen to the heartbeat of humanity, he is called a demagogue. I never ran against Theodore Roosevelt for president, although I did get to attend his funeral twice. First time was when he was defeated by Woodrow Wilson in 1912. The second time was when they finally buried him 5 years ago. Well, Theodore, you spent your whole career glorifying war and conquest. You rode into office charging up San Juan Hill. You were always the loudest voice urging war as a solution. How sad that in the twilight of your life you lost your son on the battlefields of France. Everyone says that the bitterness of that loss is what killed you. Lord, grant your servant Theodore eternal peace. Eternal peace. Well, Theodore, I hope you find eternal peace to your liking. A national depression is a fearsome thing, and we had a bad one starting in 1893. The first thing that a president does is find someone or something other than himself to blame. President Cleveland decided the problem was a lack of trust in our currency. The president was wrong. From the very beginning, the United States recognized both gold and silver, always putting more money back into circulation. But when the Depression came, Cleveland called on Congress to put the country on the gold standard. On this issue, I could not stand with the president. The Democratic Convention of 1896 was going to be a fight for the soul of the party. Lots of skirmishes led to the showdown. A ragtag column of unemployed arrived in Washington under the banner of Coxey's Army. I knew some of those men. They petitioned for jobs and more money in circulation. Instead, Cleveland had them arrested for trespassing on the Capitol lawn. That summer, a strike against the Pullman Car Company by the American Railway Union, led by Eugene Debs, tied up all of the railroads in and out of Chicago. They protested with a petition protesting the interference with their right to organize. Instead, President Cleveland sent in federal troops as strikebreakers over the objection of Governor Altgeld, and then he used the Sherman Antitrust Act to get a federal court injunction against the unions, and he had Deb thrown in jail for contempt of court. The platform that we drafted in the 1896 convention was a repudiation of our own President Cleveland. Cleveland lived on for 12 more years after he left the White House. He never forgave me for the humiliation he endured in 1896. I feel badly about that. I admired his integrity, but I felt so strong against his actions. President Cleveland, we were locked in a bitter struggle for over 12 years. You said lots of unkind things about me, and I said lots of things about you I wish I could take back, but I was convinced that I was right, you were wrong. And I know that you never wavered from the fact that you thought that you were right and I was wrong. Maybe we were both right. Maybe we were both too stubborn. Lord, grant your servant Grover a chorus of angels to sing his praises. When I join him, I'll see if I can't get my chorus to sing louder. The gold standard was never difficult for the farmers to understand. Making farmers pay their debts in gold dollars was driving them into bankruptcy. In 1881, a farmer could sell a bushel of corn for 63 cents. 10 years later, he got 26 cents for a bushel of corn. 10 years ago, you bought your farm for $25 an acre. Now, your land is worth $5 an acre. But the mortgage that you have to pay off in gold dollars are worth more than when you borrowed them. As my good friend Mary Lee says, you've got to raise less corn and more hell. When I arrived at the convention, I thought I had as good a chance as anyone who was mentioned as a candidate, even though the press never treated me very seriously. Throughout my travels around the country that year, I became personally acquainted with more delegates than any other man who was seriously mentioned as a candidate. I remember the first day in the convention hall running into Senator Patterson and him asking who I thought would win the nomination. I told him, I think I have as good a chance as anyone. He seemed surprised. He asked me, well, what strength do you have? I told him, well, Nebraska, they'll be for me whenever I want their vote. And half the Indian Territory, they'll be for me on the second ballot. He walked away chuckling. My chance to speak at the convention came at the close of the debate over the platform. There never was such a setting for a political speech in the history of our country. Webster says that the essential ingredients of a successful speech are eloquence, the subject, and the occasion. I knew that before I started to speak, I had two-thirds of the ingredients. I had a subject that was great enough to bring about a revolt in the Democratic Party. And after hours of unmerciful pounding by the other side, an occasion where the majority of the delegates were waiting intensely to have their views vindicated. My nervousness left me instantly as I rose to speak. I will never forget the scene. My voice filled the hall. The audience acted like a trained choir. At the end of a sentence, they would rise and shout, and at the start of the next sentence, the room would be as still as a church. Mr. Chairman and gentlemen of the convention, I would be presumptuous indeed to present myself against the distinguished gentleman to whom you have just listened if this were a mere measuring of abilities. But this is not a contest between persons. The humblest citizen in all the land, when clad in the armor of a righteous cause, is stronger than all the hosts of Aror. I come to speak to you in defense of a cause as holy as the cause of liberty, the cause of humanity. Never before in the history of our country have we witnessed such a contest as that through which we have just passed. Never before in the history of American politics has a great issue been debated as this issue has been, by the voters of a great party. When the advocates of gold come to us and say that we are about to disturb their business interests, we reply that you have disturbed our business interests by your course. We say that your definition of a businessman is too limited in its application. The man who is employed for wages is as much a businessman as his employer. The attorney in a country town is as much a businessman as the corporation consul in a great metropolis. The merchant at a crossroads store is as much a businessman as the merchant of New York. The farmer who sets forth in the morning and toils all day, who starts in the spring and toils all summer, and who, with the application of brain and muscle to our country's resources, creates wealth, is as much a businessman as the man who sets forth on the Board of Trade and bets upon the price of grain. The miners who go down 1,000 feet into the earth and climb 2,000 feet upon our cliffs and take from their hiding places the precious metals that are poured into the channels of trade are as much a businessman as the few financial magnates who in a back room corner the money of the world. We come to speak for this broader class of businessmen. My friends, we say not one word against those who reside on the Atlantic coast, but those hardy pioneers who have braved the dangers of the wilderness, who have made the desert to bloom as a rose, those pioneers who have reared their children near to nature's heart, where their voices can mingle with the voices of the birds, out there where they have erected schoolhouses for the education of their young, churches where they praise their Creator, and cemeteries where rest the ashes of their dead. These people, we say, are as deserving of the consideration of our party as any people in the country. It is for these people that we speak. We do not come as aggressors. Our war is not a war of conquest. We are fighting in the defense of our homes, our family, and posterity. We have petitioned, and our petitions have been scorned. We have entreated, and our entreaties have been disregarded. We have begged, and they mocked us when our calamity came. We beg no longer. We entreat no more. We petition no more. We defy them. My friends, we are about to decide upon which side will the Democratic Party fight. The sympathies of the Democratic Party, as shown by the platform, are on the side of the struggling masses, which have forever been the foundation of our party. There are two ideas of government. There are those who believe that if you will only legislate to make the well-to-do prosperous, that their prosperity will leak down on those below. The democratic idea, however, has been that if you will legislate to make the masses prosperous, that their prosperity will find its way up through every class that rests upon them. You come to us and tell us that your great cities are in favor of the gold standard. We reply that your great cities rest upon our broad and fertile prairies. Burn down your cities and save our farms, and your cities will spring up again as if by magic. But destroy our farms, and grass will grow on the streets of every city in the country. We care not upon what lines the battle is fought, having behind us the struggling masses of this nation and the world, being supported by the commercial interests and the laboring interests and toilers everywhere. We will answer their demand for a gold standard by saying to them, you shall not press down upon the brow of labor this crown of thorns. You shall not crucify mankind upon a cross of gold.
It was 1896, and I was just 16.
an alt girl ruled in Springfield, Illinois, when there came from the sunset Nebraska's shout of joy. In a coat like a deacon, in a black Stetson hat, he scourged the elephant plutocrat with barbed wire from the flat. The scales dropped from their mighty eyes. They saw that summer's noon, a tribe of wonders coming to a marching tune. And all the way to frightened Maine, the old East heard them call and saw our Bryan by a mile lead the wall of men and whirling flowers and beasts, the bard and the prophet of them all, Prairie Avenger, Mountain Lion, Bryan, 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 Bryan. Then Hannah to the rescue, Hannah of Ohio. Mark Hanna managed the McKinley campaign. He outspent us by a ratio of 10 to 1. Hanna of Ohio, promising manna, pouring out the long green to a million workers. One newspaper in Wilmington, Delaware, reported a week before the election that that city had been awarded a new shipbuilding contract that would bring thousands of new jobs to that city. But the contract had a clause in it that it would be canceled in the event I was elected. Election night at midnight. Boy Bryan's defeat. Defeat of Western Silver. Defeat of the wheat. Defeat of tornadoes by the poison vat supreme. Defeat of my boyhood. Defeat of my dream. My defeat was a narrow one. A change of 14,000 votes in five key states would have given me the victory. McKinley's plurality was accumulated largely in Pennsylvania, New York, and Massachusetts. Defeat of my boyhood. Defeat of my dream. All of my campaigns were fought from a party platform that took stand on the important issues of the day. Against imperialism, against the trust, for a tax structure that shifts more of the burden to those who can afford it, for greater regulation of the railroads. These issues required people to choose up sides. I made enough enemies in that first campaign to last a lifetime. I never chose my enemies. They just seemed to come with the issues. These issues created situations where I had numerous enemies, but I never returned the personal scorn that was heaped upon me. Occasionally, I was sorely tempted, like when I got this letter. Dear Mr. Bryan, you'd better go back to Lincoln and study science, history, and philosophy, and read Flaubert's Madame Bovary, and quit this village religion stuff. Signed, Clarence Darrow. Now, why do you suppose he'd write a letter like that? I'm sure that he was bitter about being defeated in his election to Congress, but he could hardly blame me. Governor Althoff was defeated too, and he didn't blame me. If there's anything that angers me, it's self-appointed intellectuals who look down their nose at what they call country bumpkins. Well, I wrote a letter back to that smart aleck, Clarence Darrow. Dear Mr. Darrow, I'm sorry you lost your campaign for election to Congress. Perhaps if you read less of Madame Bovary and spent more time listening to what the village people have to say about their problems, you'll achieve greater political success. Sincerely, William J. Bryan. I think that Clarence Darrow is the only man in the world who looks down on me for believing in God. He certainly made that clear during the trial here in Dayton, didn't he? Have you ever raised a radish? You put a small black seed into the black soil, and in a little while, when you return to the garden, you'll have a full-grown radish. The top is green, the body white and almost transparent, the skin a delicate red or pink. What mysterious power reaches out and gathers from the ground the particles that give it its form and size and flavor? Whose is the invisible brush that transforms to the roots, growing in darkness the hues of a summer sunset? If we were to refuse to eat anything until we could understand the mystery of its creation, we would die of starvation. But mystery, it seems, never bothers us in the dining room. It's only in the church it causes us to hesitate. I did not start out as an admirer of Woodrow Wilson. At the 1912 Baltimore Convention, when I saw Champ Clark of Missouri cozying up to J.P. Morgan and other members of the privilege-seeking class, I cast my vote for Nebraska's second choice, Governor Wilson of New Jersey. Governor Wilson, Woodrow Wilson, did not start out as one of my admirers either. When I was mentioned as a potential nominee for the third time in 1908, Wilson wrote a letter that was published in the paper. "I wish we could do something at once dignified and effective to knock Mr. Bryan into a cocked hat." When I was named Secretary of State by Wilson in 1912, the press reported that President-elect Wilson had knocked Bryan into a silk hat. To serve as Secretary of State was the greatest opportunity of my life. I wanted the chance to prove that the fundamental principles of brotherhood that Christ taught could achieve peace on an international level. I still believe that. I wanted the United States to conquer the world, not with our armies and our navies, but with our ideas. As Secretary of State, I proposed peace treaties to 30 nations, recalling for the submission of all international disputes to a permanent tribunal for investigation. 20 nations, including Great Britain and France, signed the treaties. Germany did not. Avoiding America's entry into the war that was engulfing Europe became a difficult task, especially when American lives were lost to German U-boats. A telephone ringing in the middle of the night still brings it all back. Mary was in bed. I shouted out here, "Mary, the Lusitania was sunk by a German U-boat. 1,200 civilians drowned off the shore of Ireland, including 124 Americans. This will have the warmongers demanding that we jump into the European war." I wanted our investigation of the sinking, our protest of the sinking, to suggest an investigation of the facts as provided for in our treaties. Instead, an ultimatum to Germany was proposed. I sought an immediate appointment with President Wilson. President Wilson, we've come to a parting of the ways. I cannot sign this note. It gives Germany no choice but to discontinue submarine warfare, and they won't give up that advantage. And their refusal will just call for an escalated response from us. Inevitably, it will draw us into the European war. Well, yes, I know that Theodore Roosevelt is demanding that we enter the war. But I am confident that the vast majority of Americans don't want us sending our boys to fight a European war. We would be pursuing the course our peace treaties require, to investigate and to deliberate before resorting to armed conflict. No, sir, a delay in responding will not be seen as weakness or vacillation. I realize that Germany did not sign one of our treaties, but they accepted the principle. If we send them this note without sending a similar protest to the British, we will be seen as choosing sides. England has been illegally preventing us from sending our exports where we have a right to send them. And now we have evidence that the Lusitania was carrying munitions. Shouldn't England bear some responsibility for luring American passengers onto their ships without warning them that they were carrying weapons of war? I know the cabinet considered these arguments, but the cabinet is pro-ally. It is your policies that are at stake, and the American people look to you to keep them out of this war by maintaining our neutrality. Sir, I know that you don't want this war any more than I. Years of marriage, the only real disagreement Mary and I ever had was whether I should step down as Secretary of State. I hadn't slept well for weeks, and I was greatly agitated by my inability to persuade the President that we ought to proceed with greater caution. I told her, Mary, I've been through this over and over in my mind, and I just can't see it any other way. Well, I know that you say that after I've rested and prayed over it, I'll see it differently. But I've been wrestling with this for weeks, and at some point, I have got to lay it down. Mary, I know that you're concerned that I will be labeled a traitor. But we have endured insults and accusations before. My mind was made up. I was sick at heart when I returned to the White House. But the President's decision left me no choice but to resign. I go now into the dark. Mr. President, you can rest assured I will do nothing to take this issue to the people. I will do nothing to undermine your public esteem and support. I kept that promise. After my decision was made, Mary was totally supportive. There were lots of dark moments when it seemed that she had been right, that it was a big mistake. But she never once said, I told you so, or weighed me down with regrets. After the war was over, the treaty they brought back from Paris was based off of my peace treaties, as were the plans for the League of Nations. You cannot call me an enemy of Woodrow Wilson's. I helped make him immortal. President Wilson, I will always consider serving in your cabinet as my greatest honor. My only regret is that we could not have won for you the ratification of the Treaty for the League of Nations. I would have marched to the scaffold and died with a smile on my face if I could have given you that honor. Lord, grant your servant Woodrow a silver pen. He always believed that the pen was mightier than the sword. Let the words he wrote summon the world to continue its struggle for peace. As we journey down life's road, we must pause again and again to bid farewell to some fellow traveler. At some point, as the increasing company crosses to the further shore, we become at first willing and then anxious to join them. It is God's way. My resignation freed me to return to the Chautauqua Circuit, where I could give lectures to tents full of people beside beautiful blue lakes. My most popular lecture is The Prince of Peace. I've given it 2,000 times. In Cairo, I secured a few grains of wheat that had slumbered for more than 30 centuries in an Egyptian tomb. And as I looked at them, this thought came into my mind. If one of those grains of wheat had been planted on the banks of the Nile the year after it grew, and all of its lineal descendants had been planted and replanted from that time until now, its progeny today would be sufficiently numerous to feed the teeming millions of the world. An unbroken chain of life connects the earliest grains of wheat with the grains that we sow and reap. There is an invisible something in the grain of wheat that has the power to discard the body that we see, and from air and earth fashion a new body, so much like the old one that we cannot tell the one from the other. If in this invisible germ of life in the grain of wheat there is the power to pass unimpaired through 3,000 resurrections, I shall not doubt that my soul has the power to clothe itself in a body suited to its new existence when this earthly frame has crumbled into dust. My doctors have advised me that I shouldn't eat bread. Can you imagine eating a sandwich without bread? Did you know that the sandwich was named for the Earl of Sandwich? When they renamed the Sandwich Islands the Hawaiian Islands, they should have renamed the sandwich as well. You know, I was always against the annexation of Hawaii. 60 millionaires, all direct descendants of missionaries, and all Republicans. The missionaries went to Hawaii to do good, and they ended up doing well, very well. Seems that one way to become immortal is to have food named after you. Graham crackers, Melba toast. Well, they even named a candy bar after Grover Cleveland's daughter, Baby Ruth. borrowed his daughter's name Ruth, too. And we let her think the candy bar was named after her. The only food named after me was the grape juice we served at state dinners. They called it Bryan wine. When my first official function that I presided over as Secretary of State, we announced that we no longer would serve wine or other alcoholic beverages at State Department functions. The Russian ambassador turned to his dinner companion and said, "I've not tasted water for years, but Mr. Bryan forewarned me and I took my vodka before I came in." True water, the daily need of every living thing. It ascends from the seas, obedient to the summons of the sun, and descending showers its blessing upon the earth. Its sparkling beauty gives to the fragrant flower. Its alchemy transmits base clay into golden grain. It is the canvas upon which the finger of the infinite traces the radiant rainbow of promise. It is the drink that refreshes and adds no sorrow with it. When Mary and I traveled around the world in 1905, we were invited to a reception for Admiral Dojo in Tokyo. Everyone at the table raised a glass of champagne to toast the Admiral. I raised a glass of water. Someone said, "You should drink to the Admiral in champagne. Why do you use water?" I said, "Well, Admiral Dojo won his great victory on water, so I drink to him with water. When he wins a great victory on champagne, then I'll drink to him with champagne." This was a gift from Yachichiro Yamashita, who now calls himself Brian Yamashita. He came all the way from Japan to Lincoln after he had read some of the things that I had said about world peace. He announced that he wanted to be adopted as our son, which we politely declined, but he wouldn't take no for an answer. He ended up moving in and living with us for 5 years while he attended the University of Nebraska. But when we visited Japan, we stayed with his family. When word got out about our adopted son, we received letters from another 32 Japanese boys offering themselves for adoption. Although I took a pledge to be a total abstainer when I was 12 years old, I did not become an advocate for the prohibition laws until after my campaigns for the presidency. It's not as though that the brewing interests were very strong supporters of mine. It was just that I thought that the issue would distract people from more important questions. But by 1910, when I could see that the saloon was becoming a real threat to the children of America, I saw it as a moral question. There was only one side I could take, and I took it. And I had lots of company with other progressive reformers, but made a lot of people angry with me, too. I never espoused a more righteous cause than prohibition, or faced an enemy more worthy of attack. When the 18th Amendment went into effect on January 17, 1920, and national prohibition became a reality, the reign of tears was over. As my good friend, the Reverend Billy Sunday, put it, "The saloon will soon only be a memory. Prisons will be turned into factories. Jails will be turned into storehouses and corn cribs. Men will walk upright. Women will smile and children will laugh. Hell will be forever for rent. Reverend Billy Sunday. When I was called here to Dayton for the Scopes trial, I could not refuse. It was clearly the intention of the lawyers on the other side to put religion on trial. I was invited to join the prosecution team by the district attorney, Mr. Sue Hicks. That's right, a boy named Sue. His parents must have known that he's going to become a lawyer. Dayton became a circus. Over 100 newsmen covered the trial. They called it the trial of the century. Seems as though we have a trial of the century every other year. In a way, it was like being back on the campaign trail again with all the hoopla and the press conferences. All right, fellas, I'll answer your questions as best I can. Well, we arrived here on Thursday. As you know, Mary is in a wheelchair now, crippled by arthritis, so travel has been difficult for her. Well, we'll be meeting with the other lawyers today to plan our presentation for the court. Mr. Carrick. No, sir, I did not participate in the enactment of this law by the Tennessee legislature, although I have heard other legislatures to consider similar laws. I did write to Senator Shelton, who sponsored the law, urging him to eliminate the penalty from the law, but that advice was disregarded. So the law has a maximum penalty of a fine of $500. So no one is threatening to put anyone in jail for teaching anything. Well, Buford, how's the family? Well, that is a good question, Buford. I don't think the question of whether evolution is right or wrong is even involved. The real issue, as I see it, is the right of the people acting through their legislatures to control the schools that they create and support. Yes, sir, in the rear. Well, yes, my son William will serve as co-counsel. He has acquired some trial experience in Los Angeles, and he'll be presenting some of the legal points. It has been some time since I found myself in a courtroom. Mr. Jonas, my friend from Chicago. Well, yes, I saw John Scopes last night. I hadn't seen him since I spoke at his high school graduation ceremony. We shook hands and agreed that this would be a fight on principles that would not affect our friendship. I think that it is quite remarkable that both John Scopes and I were born in the same little town of Salem, Illinois. I told him I would pay his fine myself if the ACLU wouldn't pay it. Oh, yes, Bob. Well, I've known Clarence Darrow for 30 years, and I'm not going to let a difference of opinion on religion blot out pleasant memories of earlier days. I would be the last person on earth to tell Mr. Darrow he has to believe in anything. He is entitled to profess his agnosticism. All we are saying is that the agnostics and the atheists are not entitled to teach their theories as facts in our schools. Let them build their own schools and see how many parents want to send their children to Mr. Darrow. Mr. Minkin. Well, Wellesley and the University of Wisconsin, my criticism of them was really a criticism of what some of the professors at those schools were doing, forcing students to state views about God they really didn't hold in order to pass their examination. One study shows that while 85% of college freshmen believe in God, only 55% of college graduates do. Well, that's all we have time for today, fellas. We'll see you at the courthouse tomorrow. Mr. Ralston, the judge, was a fair man who was very polite and wanted to make everybody comfortable. He put up with a lot of insult from the defense lawyer. Mr. Darrow even objected to the opening of court with a prayer. He reminded me of that lawyer who ridiculed my father for seeking divine guidance in his decision. I gave the opening remarks to the court. May it please the court. The law of Tennessee now declares that teachers are forbidden to teach in schools supported by taxation any theory that denies the divine record of man's creation as found in the Bible. The people of this state passed this law. And the people of this state knew what they were doing when they passed this law. They knew the dangers of the doctrine of evolution, and they did not want it taught to their children. My friends, it isn't, Your Honor, it isn't proper to bring scientific experts in here to defeat the purpose of the people of this state by trying to show that this theory is something that everybody ought to believe in. The real question is, can a minority come into this state and compel a teacher to teach that the Bible is not true? Can they make the parents of these children pay the expenses of the teacher to take religion out of the heart of their children? Now, this is Mr. Hunter's civic biology book, and this is the book that Mr. Scopes was teaching. Now, here we have a diagram. Has the court seen this diagram? Well, you must see it. On page 194, we have a diagram. And this diagram purports to give someone's family tree, not only his ancestors, but his collateral relatives as well. And we are told just how many collateral relatives there are. 518,900. And in this diagram, beginning with the protozoa, we have the animals classified. And we have circles varying in size depending upon the number of species in there. 8,000 protozoa, 2,500 sponges. Now, I am satisfied from some that I've seen that there must be more than 2,500 sponges. 360,000 insects, more than two-thirds of all the animal species in this world are insects. And now we are getting near our kinfolk. 13,000 fishes, and then we have the amphibians. Now, I am not sure whether they have not yet decided to come out or have almost decided to go back. 3,500 reptiles, 13,000 birds, and then we have mammals, 3,500. And here is a little circle, and in the circle is man. Find him. Find man. Now here is the book that they were teaching your children. That man is a mammal, and so indistinguishable that they place him there with 3,499 other mammals. including elephants. Talk about putting Daniel in the lion's den. How dare these scientists put man in a little circle like that with all these animals that have an odor that extends beyond the circumference of the circle, my friends? Well, here we have our glorious pedigree, and each child is expected to copy the family tree and take it home to his family to be substituted for the Bible family tree. That is what Darwin says. Now, my friends, I beg pardon if the court please. I am so in the habit of talking to an audience instead of a court, I will sometimes say, my friend. So I happen to know that not all of them are my friend. I really wasn't surprised when Clarence Darrow cross-examined me. He published a list of 50 questions for me over 2 years ago in the Chicago Tribune. And these are the same questions he asked me when I took the witness stand. Question. Do you claim that everything in the Bible should be literally interpreted? Yes, I believe that everything in the Bible should be accepted as it is given there. Now, some of the Bible is given illustratively. For instance, ye are the salt of the earth. Now, I would not insist that man was actually made out of salt or had a flesh of salt, but it is used in the sense of salt saving God's people. Well, when I read that a big fish swallowed Jonah, it does not say whale. I believe. And I believe in a God who can make a fish and can make a man and can make both do as he pleases. Well, one miracle is just as easy for me to believe as another. It may be hard for you to believe. But for me, it is just as easy to believe in the miracle of Jonah as any other miracle in the Bible. Yes, I believe that Joshua made the sun stand still. No, I don't think that the sun went around the earth. I think that the Almighty may have used language that could be understood in those days as opposed to using language that could not be understood until Mr. Darrow was born. When the Bible says the earth was made in 6 days, I do not think that it was 6 days of 24 hours. I think the word day is used as a period, as in the day the Lord God made the heavens and earth. The creation could have continued for millions of years. Yes, I believe that Eve was the first woman on earth, and she was made from Adam's rib. No, I have not discovered where Cain found his wife. I'll leave the agnostics to hunt for her. Questions were designed to cast ridicule on everybody who believed in the Bible. They had no other purpose. I was simply trying to protect the Word of God against the greatest agnostic in the United States. I was not afraid to get on the stand and let him do his worst. I wanted the world to know. The judge should have allowed me to ask these questions that I had prepared for Mr. Darrow. Mr. Darrow, do you believe that schools bear some responsibility on how the theories they teach impact upon their students? Well, what impact do you think that Darwin's theory of evolution has on how people treat each other? If men are seen as children of one father, then war is fratricide. If men are looked upon as children of apes, what matters whether they are slaughtered or not? You say that membership in the Brotherhood of Man is not dependent upon recognizing one divine Father. Well, sir, you believe that all of the members of the Brotherhood of Man should have the same right to increase and multiply. Well, let me ask you to comment on a passage that appears in Mr. Hunter's Civic Biology book, the very book that John Scopes was teaching from. Just as certain animals or plants become parasitic on other plants or animals, these families have become parasitic on society. They not only do harm to others by corrupting, stealing, or spreading disease, but they are actually protected and cared for by the state out of public money. Largely for them, the poorhouse and the asylum exist. They take from society, but they give nothing in return. They are true parasites. Mr. Darrow, would you agree that this book suggests that certain members of the Brotherhood of Man are to be labeled as parasites? Mr. Hunter then goes on to say, speaking of those parasites, if such people were lower animals, we would probably kill them off to prevent them from spreading. Humanity will not allow this, but we do have the remedy of separating the sexes in asylums or other places and in various ways preventing intermarriage and the possibility of perpetuating such a low and degenerate race. Remedies of this sort have been tried successfully in Europe and are now meeting with success in this country. You agree that those races regarded as low and degenerate should be prohibited from propagating? Sir, who do you suggest should decide which races or persons are low and degenerate, and which are high and exalted? Who should separate the parasite from the Superman? Mr. Darrow, are you familiar with the philosophy of Nietzsche and his doctrine of the Superman? So you find that doctrine reprehensible? Well, doesn't that doctrine find its root in Darwin's theory of evolution? You think that schools should be prevented from teaching Nietzsche's doctrine of the Superman? Sir, I have here in my hand a copy of a final argument you gave last year in Chicago while you were defending Leopold and Lowe for the murder of Bobby Franks. I got four copies, cost me $2. Anyone can get it for 50 cents a piece, but I'm not selling mine. Now, there it is, page 84, quote, I am quoting you. I will guarantee that you can go down to the University of Chicago today into its big library and find over 1,000 volumes of Nietzsche. If this boy is to blame for this, where did he get it? Is there any blame attached because somebody took Nietzsche's philosophy seriously and fashioned his life on it? And there's no question that's what happened in this case. Then who is to blame? The publishers of the world are more to blame than he. The scholars of the world would be more to blame. The university would be more to blame than he is. Your Honor, it is hardly fair to hang a 19-year-old boy for the philosophy that was taught him at the university. Mr. Darrow, is that what you said while defending Leopold Monroe? So you believe that the University of Chicago is responsible for the murder of Bobby Franks because they taught Leopold and Loeb the philosophy of Nietzsche. Were the parents of Leopold and Loeb compelled by law to send their children to the University of Chicago? Yet you have come to Tennessee to tell the parents of Tennessee children that you cannot enact a law limiting the teaching of Darwin's theories of evolution in your schools. John Scopes was found guilty and given a fine. And now the case is on the way to the appellate courts, and the issue will be finally laid to rest. The trial was an exhausting ordeal for me. Mary and I decided to stay here in Dayton to rest. We really needed a vacation. I think the last vacation I really had was the 5 months I spent in the Army. As passionate as all of my political campaigns were, they never generated the level of hatred and bitterness this trial did. Even those who condemned me as a demagogue always conceded I was an honest and sincere demagogue. But when sincerity is cloaked in religion, however, the opposition seems to be possessed by a fear and loathing. I had said that Clarence Darrow was the only man in the world who looked down on me for believing in God. Well, now I see that's not so true. Mr. Mencken compares my sincerity to that of P.T. Barnum, and my faith in the Bible and God to ghostly concerns and bilge. But neither Clarence Darrow nor H.L. Mencken will deliver my eulogy. Neither of them are poets. I am not really a poet either, but I have read enough poetry to know that the truth is found in the lives we live, not in the words we speak. The words I spoke may be forgotten, but if I have lived a life of love, the love remains. You may dispute whether I have fought the good fight. You may dispute whether I have finished the course. You cannot deny that I have kept the faith.
Will be true to me, help.
there's still so much that needs to be said. Still so much that needs to be done. Lord, grant your servant William, grant that your servant William will live in mankind.